Hello guys, I hope everybody is happy and healthy. And so let us start this last part of the discussion on the decay series isotope dating methods. And this was the question which we had asked at the end of the last lecture. And the question was whether it is possible that 234 uranium may not be in circular equilibrium with its parent 238 uranium. And those of you who could not watch the last lecture for some reason, and even some of you who had watched this last lecture but now probably are wondering that what was the last lecture about, because it was about a week ago. So for all of you, let me just give you a quick recap of not only about the last lecture but also about all those important points of discussion which we had done in last three, four lectures. And if you remember, I mean, some of you may recall probably that we started this discussion by understanding the decay series. And we saw that if the first parent is a very long-lived radionuclide and all the intermediate daughters which are produced during the series decay are short-lived, that eventually all these daughters would come in equilibrium, or the decay rate would be in equilibrium with the decay rate of the first parent. So that is called circular equilibrium. And in the process of understanding that, we could see that till the circular equilibrium is achieved, till that point of time, one can determine the activity of any intermediate daughter by using the Bateman equation. So that was the discussion in our the first part of the lecture. And then we went on to look at the specific application. So when we started discussing about the specific application, we realized that there are only two scenarios which are used for application. One scenario is that once an intermediate daughter comes in disequilibrium, it can be a standalone tool where you can find out the activity which is related to the decay rate of that radionuclide alone. So that is the excess or disequilibrium part of that radionuclide will decay with its half-life, I mean with the rate controlled by its half-life. And by measuring the activity of that excess radionuclide, one can find out the time. And other scenario could be that that excess is not, it is not only the excess radionuclide which is there in your sample, but some of that particular radionuclide is also supported by its parent. That means it is also continuously being produced by parent. So that is called the parent-supported part of that radionuclide. So both can be combined to find out the activity at any given point of time. So that is related to time. So you can find out the time, that is the age of the sample in that case also. So we started with the 230 thorium example as applied in the calculation of sedimentation rate when it is a standalone tool. That means excess of thorium-230 is being decayed with time, and the rationale behind that particular application was that thorium gets separated from uranium because of its different geochemical property, because it is particle reactive, so it gets adsorbed to the sediments which are settling in an ocean water, and while the uranium remains soluble in the ocean water. So in a marine scenario, marine system, the sediments would have excess 230 thorium which is adsorbed on the surface of those grains. So by leaching out that adsorbed thorium, one can find out the time or the rate of sedimentation in that kind of setting. And then we also looked at a system where thorium-230 excess as well as thorium-230 supported by its parent 234 uranium is present. So the application which we discussed, I think, in the last lecture was about the dating of volcanic rock. So we saw that thorium-230 normalized to 232 and the uranium-238. So normalized to 232 can be used, to find out the ages by plotting a kind of isochron. So in that, assumption was that the parent of 230 thorium, which is 234 uranium, was in circular equilibrium with its parent of 238 uranium. So that led to this particular question, that is it possible that 234 uranium could become disequilibrium isotope in that series. And the reason that this question is important is because in all those applications we have discussed that the disequilibrium is achieved or the decay chain is broken only because of difference in geochemical properties of the daughter elements which are produced in the decay series. And because during different geochemical processes, different elements behave differently, and the decay products in this series are different elements, so they may get fractionated from each other, and that is how disequilibrium is achieved. But 234 uranium and 238 uranium both are isotopes of the same element. So then the question arises is that when they are the same element, uranium, so they must be behaving geochemically exactly the same. So how do they get fractionated, or if at all they get fractionated? And this question actually would not have arisen in the first place if we did not have this kind of observation. And the observation was that if you measure the activity ratio of 234 uranium to 238 uranium in any waters, whether it is marine waters or terrestrial waters, it was not, in most of the cases, it was found to be not equal to 1. That means they were in disequilibrium. That means activity of 234 uranium was actually in excess compared to the activity of 238 uranium. So this clearly indicates that yes, uranium 234 does get fractionated from its parent 238 uranium, and that is what is observed in most of the waters. So then of course people looked for the explanation for explaining this kind of isotopic fractionation, which obviously may not be controlled by the geochemical differences because both are the same element. So there are two possible explanations which are given, and both are related to the radiation damages in the crystal lattice. So in one scenario, one visualizes that during the alpha decay, when the alpha particle comes out of the radionuclide, the resulting daughter, so in this case 234 thorium, experiences a recoil, and this recoil is good enough to even displace this daughter to a distance which is significant, in a way that if it is sitting on the edge of the mineral, it may even go out of the mineral. And if it goes out of the mineral, then when it decays to its daughter 234 uranium, then 234 uranium would be in excess in that environment, which could later be taken to the aqueous solution, and then this would provide excess to that solution, and the mineral would have 238 uranium parent, which is not in equilibrium with its daughter. And the other scenario is also related to the radiation damage. Because of the alpha decay, the crystal lattice gets damaged. Particularly, this is true for those minerals which have significant concentration of uranium and thorium. So they have radiation related damages. And those damaged domains of the crystals are actually more vulnerable to get weathered. So the elements sitting closer to those radiation damages, they are removed preferentially in the water. So like for example 234 uranium, because it's a daughter product, so it is positioned closer to the radiation damaged domain. So this is preferentially leached from the mineral and taken into the aqueous solution. And eventually all those weathering solutions are taken to the ocean. So that is why you find that 234 uranium is present in excess in ocean water as well as many terrestrial waters. So this is the way one can explain this fact or this observation that 234 uranium is indeed in excess or in disequilibrium with 238 uranium. So now the question is, okay, so can we use this particular observation for our application? And the answer is yes, by finding out appropriate geochronometry equation using this 234 uranium axis. And this particular tool then can be applied to all those minerals which are actually precipitating from that aqueous solution which carries the excess 234 uranium. So like carbonates which are precipitating from such waters would also incorporate uranium, or any other uranium bearing minerals, uranium ores or even phosphates, they may carry excess 234 uranium because they are precipitated or crystallized from a solution which actually had the 234 uranium excess. Now, in that kind of scenario, keep in mind that it is not only the excess part of the uranium which would go into the crystal lattice. Even the normal uranium which had, which is not in disequilibrium, that also would be part of that particular mineral. So we start writing the expression for the total activity of 234 uranium as sum of the excess part of the 234 uranium plus the parent supported 234 uranium. So this is the expression we are writing for the total activity of 234 uranium in a system, in a mineral like carbonate or uranium bearing minerals, which is precipitated from a water which had the excess 234 uranium or disequilibrium 234 uranium. So activity of 234 uranium in such a mineral can be written as sum of the excess part of the 234 uranium activity and the supported part of the 234 uranium. And to supported part obviously would be in equilibrium with the parent. So this particular term can be replaced by the activity of the first parent 238 uranium. And for the excess part, the activity of the excess 234 uranium is of course related to the decay rate, and see lambda 234 here is the decay constant for the 234 uranium. So at any point of time t, one can determine the activity of the excess part of the 234 uranium. But here you see this zero stands for the initial. So we need to know the initial excess of 234. That means at the time of precipitation of such a carbonate, what was the excess 234 uranium? And that of course can be determined by writing this kind of expression, which says that the initial excess is equal to the total initial activity minus initial supported activity. So this is also initial and this is also initial. So the initial excess obviously would be difference between the total initial activity minus that activity which was not in excess or which is in equilibrium, that is that we are writing as a supported 234 uranium activity. So instead of in place of this term, now we would replace this particular term by this expression. So we can write the total activity in a carbonate or in a uranium mineral in this form. So this entire expression for 234 uranium excess activity can be substituted in the equation 1 for this particular term, and what we get is an equation like this. Now here you see that this is initial activity which is supported, initial activity of 234 which is supported. So this is in a way this is also same as 238 uranium activity. So now if I divide all the terms of this equation in both sides by 238 uranium, this equation can be rearranged as like this. So this is the activity ratio of 234 uranium to 238 uranium, the total activity ratio, which is the 234 uranium activity ratio initially present minus 1 times e raised to lambda 234 t plus 1. So this initial ratio of activity of 234 uranium to 238 uranium is generally symbolized as gamma 0. So this is our equation which can be used for dating purpose. So this becomes our geochronometry equation. So by using this equation, one can actually use this excess 234 uranium or disequilibrium uranium to find out the age. You see here the critical term is the gamma zero. So if gamma zero happens to be 1, that means if there was no excess initially, so there was no initial disequilibrium, then of course this entire terms becomes zero. And so you find that present day activity or the total activity that you measure is also equal to 1. So that means there was, so this remains in equilibrium. So if it starts with equilibrium, it remains. So that is obvious. And another thing you can look at from this equation is that if T gets larger as the time passes by, this term becomes smaller and smaller, and eventually this entire terms become negligible. and this activity approach is one. So this is a process of achieving the circular equilibrium. So when we say the time passes by or time becomes larger, that depends upon the decay rate. So it is about few hundred thousand years. So this is how it actually happened. This is shown in the graphical form. So if you start by an activity ratio of 234, so this is the gamma zero value. So this is initial value at time t zero. So if you start by this activity ratio 1.15, that means there was almost a 15% excess of 234 uranium in the water from which the carbonate precipitated. So after it precipitated, this activity would decay according to the equation which we had derived, and almost about 800 years later, this would approach one or circular equilibrium. So this provides us the time scales in which we can use this particular tool of 234 uranium axis. But of course, you understand that this tool can be applied only when we know the gamma zero. That means where we can estimate or we have some handle on the initial ratio of the activity of 234 and 238 uranium, there only this equation can be applied. So initial applications of this particular tool was to date the coral terraces. And coral terraces, in the beginning of discussion also, I must have mentioned, because they are very interesting proxies for sea level changes, which in turn is related to climatic changes or even tectonic related changes. So why this could be applied to coral terraces? Because people could logically show that initial activity for such corals could be estimated, and that estimate was actually the same as the activity ratio of today's seawater. So the logic was that during this time scales, the time when this coral would have formed, at that time whatever was the activity ratio in the water, in the ocean water at that time, that may not have been changed significantly from the present day activity ratio of the ocean water. Because the uranium generally is brought to the ocean like any other elements from the weathering of the terrestrial rocks. And within few hundred thousand years, so it is not expected that you would change the exposed crustal composition so significantly that your activity ratios in waters become different. So it is assumed that whatever is the water activity ratio today is there, that must have been also there when this coral precipitated. So the initial value for this coral is taken as 1.15, and using this initial gamma zero, one can date the age, or one can find out the age of the corals based on the measured activity. So suppose the activity measured is 1.04, it would correspond to around 450 or 500,000 years. So this is how this technique developed. And later on, these people have also tried to apply this on those carbonates which are terrestrial carbonates. So there we actually do not know for sure what was the initial activity for such carbonate, or what was the activity ratio of 234, 238 from in those waters from which carbonates have precipitated. But there were some innovative ideas. People started using the two approaches together. So one idea was that whatever is decrease of 234 uranium with time, that should result in the growth of parent supported 230 thorium. So people combined this with the growth of 230 thorium. And this also takes us back to our original discussion in the last lecture, that when we derived the equation for 230 thorium based decay techniques, we also assumed that the parent of 230 thorium or the supported 230 thorium was in secular equilibrium, or the parent up to 30 was in secular equilibrium with its parent. So people have actually explored that assumption and combined these two approaches, the growth up to 30, parent supported to 30, with the axis. So as the to axis to 34 decreases, as we showed in the last graph, the 230 thorium increases, which is supported by the parent. Now here there are two scenarios are shown. In one case, like what we have assumed in the last lecture, that the parent 234 is in equilibrium with its parent 238. That means the gamma zero is 1. So in that case, this is how the 230 thorium would grow with time. So this is the time axis. This is the activity ratio of 230 thorium to 238 uranium. But if the gamma ratio is 1.15, then it would grow faster, because it already start with some axis, so it would grow faster. So in that case, suppose in last class, in the last lecture, you know, if we had calculated the ages based on the activity ratio of 230 thorium supported by the parent alone, for example, the activity ratio corresponding to 0.4 would have given us an age of 55,000. But if that system had axis, 15% axis, gamma 0 1.15, then actual age would have been 10,000 years younger than this. So it would have been only 45,000 years. So one approach people used is that they did some kind of iterative calculation. So they first measured the 230 activity, 234 uranium activity, both activities, and calculated the ages based on the assumption that 234 uranium was in secular equilibrium with gamma 1. And based on that age, they went back to this equation, put the age here, and calculated the gamma zero. And then, with the help of the measured activity, they found out the age. Measured activity of 234 uranium, they found out the new age. So by this iteration, in some study, they have shown that these two approaches would converge, and they would have a more realistic ages as well as the initial gamma zero. So there are some innovative ideas where people could determine the age as well as the gamma zero values by measuring a series of samples with different activities. So these kind of techniques have been applied to cave carbonates, speleotherms, and also some other secondary cave carbonates which are related to the archaeological artifacts. So if you should search for literature based on this particular 230 thorium and 234 uranium isotopes, you would find many papers related to archaeology. So there are a lot of applications related to archaeology which are being done based on this technique. Speaking of the applications of this disequilibrium isotope, let me quickly summarize some of the important decay series isotopes and some of the important applications which are being carried out based on this disequilibrium isotope. So here some of the important isotopes are listed. So these are the isotopes in the 238 uranium series, these are the isotopes in 235 uranium series, and these are those isotopes of 232 thorium series which are being applied for different application. But as I have told you earlier also, the applications are not limited to only these. One can always come up with some interesting idea using some other isotopes as well, or maybe using these same isotopes in different ways. So far, people have been using these isotopes to calculate the sedimentation rate, as we have discussed for thorium 230, and the similar applications are being done with 231 protactinium also, because these both of them are particle reactive isotopes, particle reactive elements. So they behave similarly. So even people test the concordance of each other by applying them on the same sample. So a kind of concordia studies also have been done, and even these two isotopes are combined to find out the sedimentation rate. Similarly, radium isotopes are used to do the carbonate dating, like the way we have done with the help of 234 uranium, because radium is also soluble in water like uranium. So radium isotope, which is a little longer lived isotope, is there in 238 uranium series, and shorter lived in 228 radium is thorium 232 series. So these can also be applied in those systems which are precipitating out of the water where radium may be in excess or in disequilibrium. So there are interesting applications. For example, this particular isotope 210 lead is being used to date the ice cores and also some lacustrine sediments. And the idea here is that lead is produced by decay of many short-lived isotopes, very short-lived isotopes, but it starts, or you can have the starting point as radon. So radon is actually mass number 222, which is a daughter of 226 radium. But radon, the interesting aspect of radon is that it is a gas, as you know. So it can easily escape to the atmosphere. So atmosphere may have excess radon. So that is a disequilibrium radon in the atmosphere. And then because of snowfall or because of rainfall or even because of particle sensitive nature of lead, the whatever is lead is produced by decay of such radon in atmosphere that can be quickly removed from the atmosphere and can become part of the ice because of the subsequent snowfalls, or it may also become part of the sediments in different basins like lakes or estuaries. So then it becomes a tool for dating such ice cores or lacustrine sediments. So that kind of interesting applications are based on 210 lead. But whatever we have discussed so far, you know, taking example of thorium 230 and 234 uranium, that kind of covers all theoretical aspects or conceptual aspects of such applications. So the same kind of equations can be derived for different type of isotopic systems. So basically, applications depend on the geochemical properties of these elements and the half-life of these elements. So, otherwise, conceptually, the form of the equations which are used would remain same as we have discussed. So with that, let us stop the discussion of uranium-thorium series isotopes and their applications for geochronology. For the next topic of the discussion, let me just tell you that topic would be related to another class of isotopes which also can be used on the same time scales or similar time scales as the uranium series isotopes are used. So for the time scales of a few hundred thousand of years, this is the one class of isotopes which are decay series isotopes which are used, and there is another types of isotopes which are also used. So we will start discussing those types of isotopes from the next lecture onwards. And of course, I am not giving you the topic because I just want you to have some kind of thought what could be the other class of isotopes which are used. So let us see who actually finds that out and prepares himself or herself for discussing the next class of isotopes. So till then, thank you very much, and let me know if there are any questions or clarification that you seek. Keep enjoying the learning and remain happy and healthy. Thank you.